it's like two. Good morning, brethren, ladies, and guests. We're about to get started, so if you could find your seats in the next minute or two, we're going to start bringing the Grand Lodge party in. Also, a set of reading glasses was found. They will be up on the Grand Secretary's desk at some point, a small set of reading glasses. Thank you.
have your attention, please? May I have your attention, please? The Grand Master has asked that during the meeting that if anyone would have a cell phone on them, that it either be please turned off or placed on vibrate during the meeting. Thank you.
The Right Worshipful Grand Master. The Grand Lodge officers will take their respective stations and places.
Thank you.
By the authority in me vested as the Right Worshipful Grand Master, I hereby authorize an open communication and declare the annual Grand Communication of the Grand Lodge of Pennsylvania be now open for the dispatch of business. Brother A. Preston Van Dersen, Grand Chaplain, give the opening prayer.
Most holy and glorious Lord God, thou great architect of heaven and earth, who art the giver of all good gifts and graces, and who has promised that where two or three are gathered together in thy name, thou wilt be in the midst of them. In thy name we assemble and meet together, most humbly beseeching thee to bless us in all our undertakings, that we may know and serve thee aright, and that all our doings may tend to thy glory. Amen.
So let it be.
No man is an island. No man stands alone. Each man's joy is joy to me. Each man's grief is my own. We need one another, so I will defend each man as my brother, each man as my friend. I saw the people gather, start the song that they were singing is ringing in my heart. No man is an island. No man stands alone. Each man's joy is joy to me. Each man's
brethren, ladies and guests, the flag ceremony. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America
and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
O eternal God, through whose mighty power our fathers won their liberties of old, grant, we beseech thee, that we and all the people of the land may with loyalty, fidelity, and courage maintain these liberties. Protect and assist all who serve their country, by land, by sea, or in the air, that they, being armed with thy defense, may be protected against all perils, and may do their duty to thy honor and glory. Amen.
So it be. Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, for the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets red glare, the bombs bursting in air, came through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave for the land of the free and the home of the brave? America, America, God shed his grace on thee, and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining
I bid you fraternal greetings to all, and I thank you all for being here this morning for this great celebration where we install Pennsylvania's Grandmaster 122nd, S. Eugene Harrett. I thank everyone for coming, and with that, we will proceed. Brother Grand Marshal, it is time for the official reception of our distinguished guests. You will present them all at this time. Remarks relative to the reception of our distinguished guests will be later. The brethren, ladies, guests will remain seated while each one and or each group is received, following which we'll extend our customary Masonic greeting. Proceed.
Right Worshipful Grandmaster, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you Brother Robert C. Mitchum, Most Worshipful Past Grandmaster of the Most Worshipful Grand Lodge of Ancient Freemasons of South Carolina.
How are you? Welcome. Good to see you.
Good to see you, sir.
Right Worshipful Grandmaster, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you Brother William E. Hershey, Jr., Most Worshipful Deputy Grand Master of the Most Worshipful Grand Lodge of Ancient Free and Accepted Masons in the Commonwealth of Virginia. Right Worshipful Grand Master, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you William Sardone, Deputy Grand Master of the Grand Lodge of Free and Accepted Masons of the State of New York.
How are you?
Master.
Good to see you. Thanks.
Right Worshipful Grand Master, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you Brother Dieter Hees, Most Worshipful Grand Master of the Grand Lodge of the Most Ancient and Honorable Society of Free and Accepted Masons in the State of New Jersey.
Dieter, how are you? Thank you for coming.
Oh, my God, the best.
Right Worshipful Grand Master, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you Brother Gus Forvalis, Most Worshipful Grand Master of the Most Worshipful Grand Lodge of Ancient Free and Accepted Masons of Maryland, and Robert C. Candler, Worshipful Grand Marshal. Right Worshipful Grand Master, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you Brother Gary Kaufman, Most Worshipful Junior Grand Warden of the Grand Lodge of the Most Ancient and Honorable Society of Free and Accepted Masons in the State of Rhode Island and Providence Plantations. Right Worshipful Grand Master, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you Brother Glenn Davis, Most Worshipful Past Grand Master of the Most Worshipful Grand Lodge of Ancient Free and Accepted Masons in Delaware, and Brother Jeffrey D. Haas, Junior Grand Warden. Right Worshipful Grand Master, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you Brother Eric Shaw, Most Worshipful Deputy Grand Master of the Most Worshipful Grand Lodge of Free and Accepted Masons in the State of Ohio, and Brother Mitchell Watson, Grand Secretary. Right Worshipful Grand Master, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you Rodney Mann, Most Worshipful Grand Master of the Grand Lodge of Free and Accepted Masons of the State of Indiana, and Brother Richard J. Ellman, Grand Secretary and Past Grand Master. Right Worshipful Grand Master, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you L. Arby Humphrey, Most Worshipful Grand Master of the Most Worshipful Grand Lodge of Free and Accepted Masons in Wisconsin.
Christ Almighty, you ask that question. Your buddy over there, I know where I stand. Okay.
Carver?
Thank you.
Right, Worshipful Grand Master, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you Brother Danny W. Garbner, Most Worshipful Junior Grand Warden of the Most Worshipful Grand Lodge of Ancient Free and Accepted Masons of the State of West Virginia.
How are you? Nice to see you.
An honor to have you.
Thank you very much.
Hello, sir, how are you? You guys want to line up to the side? That'd be great.
Right Worshipful Grand Master, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you Brother Malcolm E. Harris, Most Worshipful Grand Master of the Most Worshipful Prince Hall Grand Lodge of Free and Accepted Masons of Pennsylvania, and Brother Leonard Hurd, Most Worshipful Past Grand Master, and Brother Samuel King, Most Worshipful Past Grand Master, and Brother Paul Hibner, Right Worshipful Junior Grand Warden. Right Worshipful Grand Master, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you Paul E. Todd, Most Worshipful Grand Master of the Grand Lodge, Ancient Free and Accepted Masons of Canada in the Province of Ontario. Right Worshipful Grand Master, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you Brother Christian Flores, Right Worshipful Deputy Grand Master of the Grand Orient of Parna, Brazil.
How are you? Thank you. It's great to meet
you.
Maybe from somewhere right.
Above my pleasure.
Right Worshipful Grand Master, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you Companion George Morrow, Most Excellent Grand High Priest of the Grand Royal Holy Royal Arch Chapter of Pennsylvania, and Most Excellent George R. Haynes, Grand Secretary.
How are you? Good to see you.
Right Worshipful Grand Master, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you illustrious companion Charles Bumbick, Most Puissant Grand Master of the Grand Council of Royal and Select Master Masons of Pennsylvania. Right Worshipful Grand Master, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you Sir Knight Ray Schaefer, Right Eminent Grand Commander of the Grand Commandery of Knights Templar of Pennsylvania, and Sir Knight Benjamin A. Benson, Very Eminent Grand Commander, and Sir Knight Douglas M. Rowe, Eminent Grand Recorder.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Right Worshipful Grandmaster, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you the illustrious David Glatley, 33rd degree, Commander-in-Chief of the Supreme Council of Sovereign Grand Inspectors General of the 33rd and last degree of the ancient accepted Scottish Rite of Freemasonry for the Northern Masonic Jurisdiction of the United States of America. And in the East with you, the illustrious Thomas K. Sturgeon, 33rd degree, deputy and active member for Pennsylvania and a Right Worshipful past Grandmaster. The illustrious George Nanonechny, 33rd degree, active member for Pennsylvania. And in the East with you, the illustrious Robert J. Bateman, 33rd degree, active member for Pennsylvania and Right Worshipful past Grandmaster. The illustrious Keith E. Parkinson, 33rd degree, active member for Pennsylvania. The illustrious Russell W. Baker, 33rd degree, active emeritus member for Pennsylvania. The illustrious Richard G. Hawk, 33rd degree, active emeritus member for Pennsylvania. Our junior grand warden, the illustrious Jeffrey M. Wanderling, 33rd degree, commander-in-chief, Pittsburgh Consistory of the Valley of Pittsburgh. The illustrious Kenneth Baird, 33rd degree, commander-in-chief, Harrisburg Consistory in the Valley of Harrisburg. Our grand chaplain, the illustrious David Morgans, 33rd degree, secretary in the Valley of Pittsburgh. And the illustrious David Achi, 33rd degree, secretary in the Valley of Harrisburg. Yes, sir.
There we go.
Thank you for
I appreciate it.
All right,
sir.
All right.
Welcome.
Thank you, sir.
Congratulations on 2 years.
Thank you very much.
All right.
How are you, sir?
Thank you very much for your
My pleasure.
2 years.
Thank you. Almost there.
Fabulous 2 years.
Thank you. Thank you.
Well, sir, you're the best.
Congratulations.
Thanks for coming.
Thank you. Thanks
for working out.
All right.
Good job.
Congratulations on a great 2 years.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
You got the big title.
Yeah.
Right Worshipful Grandmaster, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you Knight Companion Henry Lesher, Intendant General Division of Pennsylvania, Central General Division of Pennsylvania Eastern, of the United Grand Imperial Council of the Knights of the Red Cross of Constantine and Appendant Orders of the United States of America, Mexico, and Philippines. With him, Knight Companion John Abel, Intendant General Division, Pennsylvania Western. Knight Companion Thomas Miller, Intendant General Division of Pennsylvania Eastern. And in the East with you, Knight Companion Thomas W. Jackson, Most Illustrious Past Grand Sovereign, and Right Worshipful Past Grand Secretary. Knight Companion in East with you, Marvin G. Spiker, Past Intendant General Division, Pennsylvania East, and a Right Worshipful Past Grand Treasurer.
Oh yeah, no problem.
How are you? Good to see you. Thanks for coming.
How are you, sir?
Yes, sir. My second choice.
Damn,
you were almost here.
Yeah.
Next time. Mm-hmm.
How are you,
Smith? Nice to see you. Take care.
Thank you.
Okay.
What is it?
Thank you.
You're the only one here.
Right Worshipful Grandmaster, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you Brother George Polnar, Recorder, Sirius Shrine of Sirius International. Right Worshipful Grandmaster, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you Brother George D. Seegers, Executive Director of the George Washington Masonic Memorial.
Yes, sir.
Okay, look over here.
Matthew, how are you?
All right, good, I see you.
Right Worshipful Grandmaster, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you Brother Matthew D. Dupree, Most Excellent Grand Prior of the Grand Masters Council, United States of America, Grand Council of Knight Masons. Right Worshipful Grand Master, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you Brother Joseph E. Murphy, Chief Executive Officer of the Masonic Villages of Pennsylvania.
Well, we made it.
That's right.
Thank you for being with us.
You're right.
Thank you.
Not to know.
Right Worshipful Grand Master, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you Thomas R. Labaugh, Executive Director, Pennsylvania Masonic Youth Foundation.
I wish I could.
Brother Schaefer, how are you? All right. You guys want to line up across?
Right Worshipful Grandmaster, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you Brother Gregory Schaefer, Executive Officer of the Pennsylvania International Order of DeMolay, and with him, Jacob Beers, State Master Counselor, Pennsylvania DeMolay, and Matthew Flores, Second Counselor, Chapter Apolina de Tigra, Parna, Brazil.
One more kitty.
Right Worshipful Grandmaster, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you Helen B. Snedden, Supreme Deputy, Pennsylvania Rainbow of the International Order of Rainbow for Girls, and Amanda Herzog, Grand Worthy Advisor. Right Worshipful Grandmaster, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you Kimberly Miller, Grand Guardian of the International Order of Job's Daughters, and with her, Elena Landry, Miss Job's Daughter of Pennsylvania. Right Worshipful Grandmaster, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you Emily D. McCarthy, Worthy Grand Matron of the Order of the Eastern Star, Grand Chapter of Pennsylvania, and Brother Donald C. Gravener, Worthy Grand Patron. Right Worshipful Grandmaster, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you Cynthia Steed, Grand Royal Matron of the International Order of Amaranth of Pennsylvania, and Brother George Yorich, Grand Royal Patron.
Brethren, ladies, and guests, please stand and give a round of applause for our distinguished guests.
Sit back on you again.
The annual reports of most of the Grand Lodge committees were presented at the quarterly communication held Wednesday, December 6th last. As there are additional reports requiring Grand Lodge action, I will call on them at this time. Almoners of the Grand Lodge Charity, funds of the bursars of the Thomas Rankin Patton Memorial Charity Fund, and stewards of the Stephen Gerard Charity Fund. Brother Mark A. Haynes, Right Worshipful Grand Secretary.
Right Worshipful Grand Master, be it resolved that the sum of $30,000 be appropriated to the almoners of the Grand Lodge Charity Fund for the year beginning December 27, 2018, to be drawn in the usual manner. Be it resolved that the sum of $26,000 be appropriated to the stewards of the Stephen Gerard Charity Fund for the year ending December 27, 2018, to be drawn in the usual manner. Resolved that the sum of $5,000 be appropriated to the bursars of the Thomas R. Patton Charity Fund for the year ending December 27, 2018, to be drawn in the usual manner. Right Worshipful Grand Master, I move for the adoption of this resolution.
Right Worshipful Grand Master, I second the motion.
Brethren, you've heard read the motion. All those in favor give their consent by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. The ayes have it, so ordered, Right Worshipful Grand Secretary. Right Worshipful Grand Secretary, present the proposed lodge mergers.
Right Worshipful Grand Master, the following have complied with the necessary requirements. Be it resolved that Grand Lodge adopt the following resolution. Resolved that the Grand Lodge approve the merger of Fairless Hills Lodge number 776 into Newtown Lodge number 427, effective December 27, 2017, to be known as Newtown Lodge number 427. Right Worshipful Grand Master, I move the adoption of this resolution.
Right Worshipful Grand Master, I second the motion.
Brethren, you've heard the motion. All those in favor give their consent by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. The ayes have it, so ordered, Right Worshipful Grand Secretary. Brother Grand Marshal. Conduct Brother George D. Seegers, Executive Director of George Washington Masonic Memorial, to the East to make a presentation.
Grand Master, may I address the assembly?
Yes.
Ladies and gentlemen, I think at this time of the year it's appropriate to pause to reflect and remember the father of our nation, the one man who did more and gave more for the creation of this great nation than any other. Most Worshipful Grand Master, Deputy Grand Master, Grand Wardens, my brethren, ladies and guests, I bring you warm fraternal greetings from the George Washington Masonic National Memorial Association. I want to thank you for affording me the honor and pleasure of attending your annual communication. First and foremost, I extend our sincere thanks for your support of the memorial in the past, the present, and into the future. I believe the character of Washington is the character of America. Perhaps no other American citizen, however distinguished in public life, was ever so completely American. His entire life was lived in his own country. There was no foreign education or habits or tastes acquired abroad. He was born and spent his childhood and early youth in Virginia. In his young manhood, his first public service was engaging in the military defense of his state during the French and Indian Wars. His early manhood was spent in actively managing his estate at Mount Vernon. As a mature man, he dedicated his life to his country's defense and to the establishment of this great nation. His last years were spent at his beloved Mount Vernon, where he enjoyed a few short years of quiet before passing to his much-deserved rest. His calm and dignified passing took place in the home that had been the first home of his manhood and the center of his life. His person, his character, and his greatness were truly and totally American. As an example of American greatness, it is our privilege and our duty to commemorate him, to contemplate and revere his character, and to transmit from generation to generation not only the memory of his excellence, but also the examples and evidence of his character, which were so central to the establishment of this republic of ours. We should not consider Washington as being in the past. Rather, we should consider him in the present. He must remain a living influence, a power which never grows old, an example of what American citizen can and should be. America and Washington are intimately connected. The character of Washington was in many ways formed and influenced by his membership and experiences in Freemasonry. And America was in many ways formed by the actions, thoughts, and words of Washington. When not yet 21 years of age, he sought admission to our fraternity. Through all his life, he worked in the temple of his character and maintained his Masonic connections and activities. Through the years of the Revolution, he attended lodges, often in tents, and frequently visited lodges in the areas and cities that he traveled to throughout the colonies. Washington did not hide his Masonry. He was openly and actively involved. Ladies and gentlemen, the George Washington Masonic Memorial, honoring and perpetuating the memory and legacy of George Washington, is a valid, meaningful, and inspiring contribution to the betterment of mankind. The physical structure of the memorial is symbolic of the greatness and character of the man it memorializes, and it must be preserved. Designed in the classical fashion, symbolizing the classical reference and model for the new nation created by Washington and our founding fathers. Built of granite, symbolizing the strength, courage, and perseverance of Washington, and erected on the highest hill in the area, pointing to the heavens, symbolizing the divine guidance and providence that Washington believed was guiding his efforts in creating our nation. The memorial was conceived and constructed as a physical representation of the admiration and respect that Freemasons hold for him in whose honor and memory it was erected. Our first citizen, our first president, and surely our foremost Freemason, Brother George Washington. It was his courage, his strength of character, his integrity, his perseverance, and his belief in divine providence that guided and were the deciding factors in the success of the American Revolution and the founding of the United States of America. We must not allow his name, his legacy, and his memory to fade away. We must keep him as our example and model of what a citizen and a Freemason should and can be. The character and virtues and vision of Washington must be preserved and transmitted to this and future generation. Brethren, the greatest gift George Washington gave us was our freedom. The memorial was built by our Masonic forefathers to acknowledge not only that gift, but all that he gave and all that he did for us. Now it is our turn to do our part for the eternal perpetuation of the memory and legacy of George Washington. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Brother Tom, would you join me up here, please?
Right, Worshipful Grand Master, on behalf of the George Washington Memorial, we'd like to present you with this plaque for the dedication that you showed this year when we decided that Pennsylvania will join the group of other 30 Grand Lodges who donate $1 a member for the perpetual care of the memorial.
Thank you.
Let's get a picture. Come up here. All right. Thank you very much.
I didn't know that was going to happen.
Okay.
Thank you, Grandmaster.
Thank you. Brother Grand Marshal, conduct Brother Right Worshipful Past Grand Master Ronald A. Unk Sr. to the east for a presentation.
Right Worshipful Grand Master, in 1984, our jurisdiction, our Grand Lodge, established the Masonic Model Student Assistance Program, a program designed to train educators, teachers, administrators, and staff to identify children who were in harm's way. And in the past years, many of you have heard about the bullying, and we too have addressed this as well. It is critical to identify these children in tough times of their life to prevent sometimes the most tragic end and loss of life. So, Grandmaster, as a director of the Masonic Model Student Assistance Program, it gives me great pleasure to present to you in recognition of this program being established here in Pennsylvania, and now is throughout the entire jurisdiction of the United States.
If you would, please. Brother Grand Marshal, conduct Brothers Walter Cook and Brother David Howe, past master, to the east for a presentation.
Ready. I'm next. Make sure he's ready.
On this joyous occasion, Right Worshipful Grand Master, I am privileged to present to you a token of the workmanship of the Roosters Club woodshop, the Robert E. Umbaugh woodshop. And it signifies our interest in continuing crafts of all kinds. Come and visit us, and thank you. And we hope that I can cut it a little shorter if it helps. But thank you.
Thank you. Can you come up here? Can you come up?
Photo moment. Good man. Thank you.
Worshipful Master, on a less serious note, I'd like to present you with one of my Masonic Santa Clauses made at the woodshop and also signed by all the members of the woodshop. And if you get tired of it, it's wooden, so it'll burn real well.
Okay.
All the way over here. I'm gonna put you on every side. One second. Ready? Thank you. Very appropriate that I would be given the two-ball cane at this point, because when I think of a cane, I think of a hook on the end that they pull you off the stage and tell you you are finished. So, good morning. 3 weeks ago in Philadelphia, I delivered my final quarterly address as Grand Master of this incredible jurisdiction. In that speech, I gave you my take on the state of the fraternity, on the programs that have been enacted, and the projects that have been completed. You will all be relieved to know that I'm not going to do that again. Today is not about me. It is a day to celebrate the installation of our next Grand Master, Right Worshipful Gene Harrett. Brother Gene, I wish you and Lady Sally the best during these upcoming years. I know you'll be an excellent steward of the craft, and I hope the brethren support you as they have me. It is hard to believe that these 2 years have come to a close. I owe a debt of gratitude that can never be repaid to all of you who have helped me during this journey. To the past Grand Masters, particularly Brother Sam Williamson and Brother Tom Sturgeon, for your counsel and your guidance, I humbly thank you. The staff of the Grand Lodge, especially Brother Mark Haynes and Brother Joe Murphy and the Masonic Village employees, are top-notch. They have been incredibly helpful to me during my term. The District Deputy Grand Masters have been my right-hand men and acting as liaisons to the districts. No Grand Master can do this job without good deputies, and I was very, very lucky to have some of the best. Another group that deserves credit is the aides. You have no idea how much effort they put into making everything seem effortless. Howard Silball, Bill Kratzenberg, Vince Minardo, and all the aides make sure things happen when, where, and how they should, and I can't thank them enough. Please join me in recognizing our aides. I am grateful to the Right Worshipfuls for supporting me, traveling with me, and being part of this administration. I will be here for you whenever and whatever needs you have in the future. To my Uncle Ray, I say thank you. Thank you for being one of the men I admire most and being a role model for me since I was a child. To my wonderful wife, Lynn, my beautiful daughters, Jennifer and Jessica, I thank you for your behind-the-scenes support, as well as always being there for me since the beginning of this journey. I love you all with all my heart. And mentioning Lady Lynn, I also have to say a special thank you to Cheryl Dietz and Kathy Glasser for being there to assist Lady Lynn both in planning some of her events and while I was traveling for Grand Lodge. We both appreciate what each of you have done for us. And finally, to you, my beloved brothers, I thank you for being part of this experience with me. I thank you for welcoming me into your homes, your districts, your lodges, and your lives as I traveled the state over these past 8 years. Most of all, thank you for giving me the opportunity to serve this great jurisdiction. I have tried to make the most of every day of it, and it has been one of the greatest honors of my life. Thank you.
emergency outside for Brian Maxwell. He's in here. They need him immediately outside.
Brother Ed Stumm, escort Brother Brian Maxwell to the outer doors. Brian Maxwell, please arise. Right Worshipful Grand Secretary. Okay. I'm just testing what I have to say next.
This is the moment. This is the day, this is the moment when I know I'm on my way. Every endeavor I have made ever is coming into play, is here and now today. This is the moment. This is the time when the momentum and the moment are in rhyme. Give me this moment, I'll gather up my past and make some sense at last. This is the moment when all I've done, all of the dreaming, screaming, and scheming becomes one. This is the day, just see it shine, when all I've lived for becomes mine. This is the moment, this is the hour, when I can open up tomorrow like a flower, and put my hand to everything I plan to fulfill my grand design, see all my stars align. This is the moment, my final test. Destiny beckoned, I never reckon second best. I will look down, I must not fall. This is the moment, the sweetest moment of them all. This is the moment, damn all the odds. This day or never, I sit forever with the gods. When I look back, I will recall, moment for moment, this was the moment, the greatest moment of them all.
If you would, please. Right Worshipful Grand Secretary, read so much the minutes of the quarterly communication held December 6, 2017, as it relates to the election of the Grand Lodge officers.
Right Worshipful Grand Master, this being the time prescribed by the Hyman Reason for the annual election of Grand Officers to serve this Grand Lodge during the ensuing Masonic year beginning on St. John the Evangelist's Day next, the following brethren were duly elected. Brother Stuart Eugene Herrett, Right Worshipful Grand Master. Brother Thomas Gammon IV, Right Worshipful Deputy Grand Master. Brother Jeffrey Mark Wunderling, Right Worshipful Senior Grand Warden. Brother Larry Arthur Durr, Right Worshipful Junior Grand Warden. Brother Jeffrey Wayne Coy, Right Worshipful Grand Treasurer. And Brother Mark Allen Haynes, Right Worshipful Grand Secretary.
Brother Larry Arthur Durr, you have been elected Right Worshipful Junior Grand Warden to serve this Grand Lodge for the present Masonic year and until your successor is duly installed. Are you prepared to take upon yourself the necessary obligations?
I am, Right Worshipful Grand Master.
Brother Grand Marshal, conduct the Right Worshipful Junior Grand Warden elect to the front of the altar. Brother Larry Arthur Durr, remove your Masonic clothing, kneel upon both knees in front of the altar, and lay both hands upon the Holy Bible, square and compass. Right Worshipful Junior Grand Warden, install Brother Larry Arthur Durr.
You will say aye. Pronounce your name in full and recite your obligation.
I, Larry Arthur Durr, of my own free will and accord, in the presence of Almighty God and this Right Worshipful Grand Lodge, do hereby, herein, and hereon, most solemnly, sincerely, and truly, promise, declare, and swear that I will serve as Right Worshipful Junior Grand Warden of the Grand Lodge of Pennsylvania for the present Masonic year, and until my successor is duly installed, beginning this day. I will attend the annual, quarterly, special, and extra meetings, take my station therein, and perform the duties thereof, to the best of my ability, unless prevented by sickness or some other unavoidable occurrence. In the absence of the Right Worshipful Senior Grand Warden, I will take his station therein, and perform the duties thereof. In the absence of the Right Worshipful Deputy Grand Master and the Right Worshipful Senior Grand Warden, I will take the station of the Right Worshipful Deputy Grand Master and perform the duties thereof to the best of my ability. In the absence of the Right Worshipful Grand Master, the Right Worshipful Deputy Grand Master, and the Right Worshipful Senior Grand Warden, I will take the station of the Right Worshipful Grand Master and perform the duties thereof to the best of my ability. I will keep, support, maintain, and abide by all the ancient usages, customs, and landmarks of the fraternity and the Constitution, rules, regulations, and edicts of the Grand Lodge of Pennsylvania. I will assist the Right Worshipful Grand Master in seeing duly enforced, to all which I swear without any equivocation, mental reservation, or self-evasion of mind, in me whatever, but with a firm and steadfast resolution to keep and perform the same, binding myself under no less a penalty than that of having the penalties of all my former obligations inflicted upon me at one in the same time, if that were possible, So help me God and keep me steadfast in this, my right worshipful junior grand warden's oath and obligation.
You will kiss the Holy Bible and arise. I now invest you with the collar, to which is pendant the jewel of your office, the plum. It's not gonna stay. Also with the apron, upon which is embroidered a representation of the same jewel. I present you with a copy of the Hymen Reason, the Constitution of the Grand Lodge of Pennsylvania, which you have sworn to assist the Right Worshipful Grand Master in seeing duly enforced. I also present you with your column. It is the emblem of your authority. When the Grand Lodge is at labor, you will place it in a horizontal upon your pedestal in a horizontal position with the base toward the south. When called onto labor, you will place it in a perpendicular position. The Grand Lodge is then in your charge. You may permit brethren to retire, but allow no one to enter. I will now conduct you to your station.
Brother Grand Marshal, make the usual proclamation.
Brethren, take notice that Brother Larry Arthur Durr, having been duly elected and installed Right Worshipful Junior Grand Warden of the Right Worshipful Grand Lodge of the most ancient and honorable fraternity of free and accepted Masons of Pennsylvania and Masonic jurisdiction thereunto belonging, is hereby proclaimed as such. Brethren, take notice that Brother Larry Arthur Durr, having been duly elected and installed Right Worshipful Junior Grand Warden of the Right Worshipful Grand Lodge of the most ancient and honorable fraternity of free and accepted Masons of Pennsylvania and Masonic jurisdiction thereunto belonging, is hereby proclaimed as such. Brethren, take notice that Brother Larry Arthur Durr, having been duly elected and installed Right Worshipful Junior Grand Warden of the Right Worshipful Grand Lodge of the most ancient and honorable fraternity of free and accepted Masons of Pennsylvania and Masonic jurisdiction thereunto belonging, is hereby proclaimed as such.
Brother Jeffrey Mark Wunderling, you have been elected Right Worshipful Senior Grand Warden to serve this Grand Lodge for the present Masonic year and until your successor is duly installed beginning this day. Are you prepared to take upon yourself the necessary obligation?
I am, Right Worshipful Grand Master.
Brother Grand Marshal, conduct the Right Worshipful Senior Grand Warden elect to the front of the altar.
Thank you.
Brother Jeffrey Mark Wunderling, remove your Masonic clothing, kneel upon both knees in front of the altar, and lay both hands upon the Holy Bible, square in compasses. Right Worshipful Senior Grand Warden, install Brother Jeffrey Mark Wunderling.
You will say, I pronounce your name in full and recite your obligation.
I, Jeffrey Mark Wunderling, of my own free will and accord, in the presence of Almighty God and this Right Worshipful Grand Lodge, do hereby, herein, and hereon, most solemnly, sincerely, and truly, promise, declare, and swear that I will serve as Right Worshipful Senior Grand Warden of the Grand Lodge of Pennsylvania for the present Masonic year and until my successor is duly installed, beginning this day. I will attend the annual grand, quarterly, special, and extra communications of the Grand Lodge of Pennsylvania, take my station therein, and perform the duties thereof to the best of my ability, unless prevented by sickness or some other unavoidable occurrence. In the absence of the Right Worshipful Deputy Grand Master, I will take his station and perform the duties thereof to the best of my ability. In the absence of the Right Worshipful Grand Master and the Right Worshipful Deputy Grand Master, I will take the station of the Right Worshipful Grand Master and perform the duties thereof to the best of my ability. I will keep, support, maintain, and abide by all the ancient usages, customs, and landmarks of the fraternity, and the Constitution, rules, regulations, and edicts. I will assist the Right Worshipful Grand Master in seeing duly enforced. To all of which I swear, without any equivocation, mental reservation, or self-evasion of mind in me whatever, but with a firm and steadfast resolution to keep and perform the same, binding myself under no less a penalty than that of having the penalties of all my former obligations inflicted upon me at one and the same time, if that were possible. So help me God, and keep me steadfast in this, my Right Worshipful Senior Grand Warden's oath and obligation.
You will kiss the Holy Bible and arise. I now invest you with the collar, to which is pendant the jewel of your office, the level. Also with the apron, upon which is embroidered a representation of the same jewel. I present you with a copy of the Hymn of Reason, the Constitution of the Grand Lodge of Pennsylvania, which you have sworn to assist the Right Worshipful Grand Master in seeing duly enforced. Also with a gavel with which you will assist the Right Worshipful Grand Master in preserving order. I also present you with your column. It is the emblem of your authority. When the Grand Lodge is at labor, you will place it upon your pedestal in a perpendicular position. When called off from labor, you will place it in a horizontal position with the base toward the south. I will now conduct you to your station.
Brother Grand Marshal, make the usual proclamation.
Brethren, take notice that Brother Jeffrey Mark Wunderling, having been duly elected and installed Right Worshipful Senior Grand Warden of the Right Worshipful Grand Lodge of the Most Ancient and Honorable Fraternity of Free and Accepted Masons of Pennsylvania and Masonic Jurisdiction thereunto belonging, is hereby proclaimed as such. Brethren, take notice that Brother Jeffrey Mark Wunderling, having been duly elected and installed Right Worshipful Senior Grand Warden of the Right Worshipful Grand Lodge of the Most Ancient and Honorable Fraternity of Free and Accepted Masons of Pennsylvania and Masonic Jurisdiction thereunto belonging, is hereby proclaimed as such. Brethren, take notice that Brother Jeffrey Mark Wunderling, having been duly elected and installed Right Worshipful Senior Grand Warden of the Right Worshipful Grand Lodge of the Most Ancient and Honorable Fraternity of Free and Accepted Masons of Pennsylvania and Masonic Jurisdiction thereunto belonging, is hereby proclaimed as such.
Brother Thomas Gammon IV, you have been elected Right Worshipful Deputy Grand Master to serve this Grand Lodge for the present Masonic year and until your successor is duly installed beginning this day. Are you prepared to take your necessary obligation?
I am, Right Worshipful Grand Master.
Brother Grand Marshal, conduct the Right Worshipful Deputy Grand Master elect in front of the altar. Brother Thomas Gammon IV, remove your Masonic clothing, kneel upon both knees in front of the altar, and lay both hands upon the Holy Bible, square and compasses. Right Worshipful Deputy Grand Master, install Brother Thomas Gammon IV.
Your name and recite your obligation.
I, Thomas Gammon IV, of my own free will and accord, in the presence of Almighty God and this Right Worshipful Grand Lodge, do hereby, herein, and hereon, most solemnly, sincerely, and truly, promise, declare, and swear that I will serve as Right Worshipful Deputy Grand Master of the Grand Lodge of Pennsylvania for the present Masonic year and until my successor has been duly installed, beginning this day. I will attend the annual grand, quarterly, special, and extra communications, take my station therein and perform the duties thereof to the best of my ability unless prevented by sickness or some other unavoidable occurrence. In the absence of the Right Worshipful Grand Master, I will take his station and perform the duties thereof to the best of my ability. I will keep, support, maintain, and abide by all the ancient usages, customs, and landmarks of the fraternity, the Constitution, rules, regulations, and edicts of the Grand Lodge of Pennsylvania. I will assist the Right Worshipful Grand Master in seeing duly enforced. To all of which I swear, without equivocation, mental reservation, or self-evasion of mind and me whatever, but with a firm and steadfast resolution to keep and perform the same. So help me God, and keep me steadfast in this, my Right Worshipful Deputy Grand Master's oath and obligation.
You will kiss the Holy Bible and arise. I invest you with your collar, pendant to which is the jewel of your office. Also with your apron, upon which is embroidered a representation of that same jewel. We may have the same problem here, the opposite problem you had. Present you with a copy of the Hymen Reason, the Constitution of the Grand Lodge of Pennsylvania, which you have sworn to assist the worshipful Great Worshipful Grand Master in seeing duly enforced. Yeah. In the beginning of something special here. Mm-hmm. I will now conduct you to your station.
Brother Grand Marshal, make the usual proclamation.
Brethren, take notice that Brother Thomas Gammon IV, having been duly elected and installed Right Worshipful Deputy Grand Master of the most ancient and honorable fraternity of free and accepted Masons in Pennsylvania and Masonic jurisdiction thereunto belonging, is hereby proclaimed as such. Brethren, take notice that Brother Thomas Gammon IV, having been duly elected and installed Right Worshipful Deputy Grand Master of the most ancient and honorable fraternity of free and accepted Masons in Pennsylvania and Masonic jurisdiction thereunto belonging, is hereby proclaimed as such. Brethren, take notice that Brother Thomas Gammon IV, having been duly elected and installed Right Worshipful Deputy Grand Master of the most ancient and honorable fraternity of free and accepted Masons in Pennsylvania and Masonic jurisdiction thereunto belonging, is hereby proclaimed as such.
Brother Stuart Eugene Hart, you have been elected Right Worshipful Grand Master to serve this Grand Lodge for the present Masonic year and until your successor is duly installed beginning this day. Are you prepared to take upon yourself the necessary obligations?
I am Right Worshipful Grand Master.
Brother Grand Marshal, conduct the Right Worshipful Grand Master elect in front of the altar.
That's where we're first.
Brother Stuart Eugene Hart, remove your Masonic clothing, kneel upon both knees in front of the altar, and lay both hands upon the Holy Bible, square and compasses. You will say, I, pronounce your name in full and recite your obligation.
I, Stuart Eugene Herod, of my own free will and accord, in the presence of Almighty God and this worshipful Grand Lodge, do hereby, hereon, herein, and hereon, most solemnly, sincerely, and truly, promise, declare, and swear that I will serve as Right Worshipful Grand Master of the Grand Lodge of Pennsylvania for the present Masonic year until my successor is duly installed beginning this day. I will attend the annual, quarterly, special, and extra communications, take my station therein, and perform the duties thereof to the best of my ability, unless prevented by sickness or some other unavoidable occurrence. I will keep, support, maintain, and abide by all the ancient usages, customs, and landmarks of the fraternity, the Constitution, rules, regulations, and edicts of the Grand Lodge of Pennsylvania. I will see duly enforced, to all of which I swear, without any equivocation, mental reservation, or self-evasion of mind in me whatever, but with a firm and steadfast resolution to keep and perform the same. So help me God and keep me steadfast in this, my Right Worshipful Grand Master's oath and obligation.
You will kiss the Holy Bible and arise. I now invest you with the collar, to which is pendant the jewel of your office. Assist, please. Hello, are you back here? I present to you a copy of the Hymen Reason, the Constitution of the Grand Lodge of Pennsylvania, which you have solely duty to enforce. Also, your gavel. It is an emblem of your authority. One rap commands silence. Two raps call up the Grand Lodge officers. Three raps the entire Grand Lodge, and one rap seats them. And your hat, which you will wear in all Grand Lodge sessions except during prayer and other special occasions. I will now conduct you to your office.
Congratulations.
Thank you, sir.
I thought I was done. Grand Marshal, make the proclamation.
Brethren, take notice that Brother Stuart Eugene Harrett, having been duly elected and installed Right Worshipful Grand Master of the most ancient and honorable fraternity of free and accepted Masons in Pennsylvania and Masonic jurisdiction thereunto belonging, is hereby proclaimed as such. Brethren, take notice that Stuart Eugene Harrett, having been duly elected and installed Right Worshipful Grand Master of the most ancient and honorable fraternity of free and accepted Masons in Pennsylvania and Masonic jurisdiction thereunto belonging, is hereby proclaimed as such. Brethren, take notice that Brother Stuart Eugene Harrett, having been duly elected and installed Right Worshipful Grand Master of the most ancient and honorable fraternity of free and accepted Masons in Pennsylvania and Masonic jurisdiction thereunto belonging, is hereby proclaimed as such.
Brother Grand Marshal, conduct the Right Worshipful Grand Master along with Brother David Morgans, Grand Chaplain, and Lady Sally to the altar.
Let us pray. Almighty and most gracious Lord God, we bow our hearts and heads before you in grateful thanksgiving for the many blessings you have bestowed upon us. We acknowledge that you and you alone are the source of all good gifts and graces. We thank you for this country and the freedom it affords. We thank you for this fraternity and the brotherhood it offers. And we especially thank you for Stuart Eugene Harrett and the many gifts and talents you have breathed into him. Lord, he humbly kneels before you, seeking your guidance and blessings as he continues down his road of leadership in the Masonic fraternity. We ask that you give him wisdom to apply his great knowledge of the craft, that he may lead and inspire the Freemasons of Pennsylvania to live up to and into the tenets they vowed to uphold. We ask that you give him energy to serve and a clear vision for the future, that he may ascribe glory to you and honor to the fraternity. We ask that you give him courage to stay true to his convictions, that he may be a steadfast and good leader. And we ask that you fill him with brotherly love and affection, that all his doings may prosper and enlighten our membership. Heavenly Father, we also ask that you grant strength, compassion, wisdom and understanding to Sally as she travels this road side by side with her adoring husband. We ask that you give her peace and comfort as she mourns the passing of her mother. And we ask that over the next 2 years, that you would use the opportunities challenges, and demands of serving as Grand Master to strengthen Gene and Sally's marriage, to share wonderful experiences with their families and friends, and to deepen their trust and reliance on you. Supreme and Sovereign Grand Architect of the Universe, we ask that you give great success to our Grand Master as in all that he does. We ask that you protect him from all harm and grant him traveling mercies as he goes out into your world as an ambassador of Masonry. And we ask that you inspire him to inspire others. As he rises from this altar, may he do so in the assurance of knowing that you will never leave him nor forsake him, and that you have appointed him and uniquely gifted him to serve as the Right Worshipful Grand Master of the State of Pennsylvania. We thank you, we praise you, and we glorify your holy name. Amen.
So would it be.
I just want you to know that I haven't kissed my wife for 4 days because we've each had colds and didn't want to spread it. But that one was worth it. Brother Grand Marshal, present Lady Lynn Dietz to the East so she may present Right Worshipful Past Grand Master Raymond T. Dietz with his Past Grand Master's jewel, apron, and lapel pin. Brother Raymond T. Dietz, Right Worshipful Past Grand Master, I present to you your commission as Past Grand Master.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
You have a picture.
Okay. Photoshop could have fixed that.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you. Right Worshipful Grand Secretary, read the summary of the resolution for the creation of the Pennsylvania Franklin Medal.
Right Worshipful Grand Master, at the March 7th, 1979 quarterly communication, and under the direction of the Right Worshipful Grand Master, Brother Walter P. Wells, the Grand Lodge of Pennsylvania adopted a resolution for the creation of the Pennsylvania Franklin Medal to honor Brother Benjamin Franklin, who served this Grand Lodge as Right Worshipful Grand Master in 1734 and 1749. The purpose of the medal is to honor other distinguished members of the craft who have rendered outstanding service to Freemasonry in general or to this Grand Lodge in particular. The intended recipients are chosen by the Right Worshipful Grand Master, Right Worshipful Deputy Grand Master, Right Worshipful Senior Grand Warden, and Right Worshipful Junior Grand Warden.
Brother Grand Marshal, present our recipient to the East. Brother Thomas K. Sturgeon, please approach the east and present the Franklin Medal to your friend. Lunch is going to be delayed just a little bit. Thank you.
Good job, huh? All over.
Thank you very much. You're welcome. My appointments for the following positions for the year 2018 are as follows. And will the new district deputy grand masters please stand and be recognized as your name is announced by the grand secretary.
Brother Ronald B. Carson, lodge number 476, district deputy grand master of the first Masonic district, vice brother Larry A. Durr. Brother Henry J. Federowitz, lodge number 464, district deputy grand master of the second Masonic district, vice brother Scott Matinchek. Brother M. Leonard Bell, Lodge number 307, District Deputy Grand Master of the 7th Masonic District, Vice Brother James R. Shaw. Brother Philip A. Rickard, Lodge number 324, District Deputy Grand Master of the 19th Masonic District, Vice Brother Terrence I. Elliott. Brother Lawrence J. Bellotto, Lodge number 281, District Deputy Grand Master of the 20th Masonic District, Vice Brother Jack H. Speech. Brother John W. Rees, Sr., Lodge number 598, District Deputy Grand Master of the 22nd Masonic District, Vice Brother John W. Wells II. Brother Joshua S. Freeman, Lodge number 331, District Deputy Grand Master of the 30th Masonic District, Vice Brother Timothy L. Schumar. Brother Larry D. Horath, Lodge number 337, District Deputy Grand Master of the 31st Masonic District, Vice Brother Robert A. Farquhar. Brother Gregory A. Dimoff, Lodge number 688, District Deputy Grand Master of the 34th Masonic District, Vice Brother Robert C. Snyder II. Brother Franklin E. Hort, Sr., Lodge number 224, District Deputy Grand Master of the 35th Masonic District, Vice Brother J. Kevin Jones. Brother David J. Kaufman, Lodge number 776, District Deputy Grand Master of the 36th Masonic District, Vice Arthur R. Bartholomew. And Brother Quint A. Anderson, Lodge number 521, District Deputy Grand Master of the 52nd Masonic District, Vice Brother John W. Postlewaite.
Please receive them. Brethren, you may be seated. I look forward to working with you, and I thank you for taking these appointments. I'd like to recognize the District Deputy Grand Masters who have completed their service for the Grand Lodge. Please stand and be recognized as your name is announced by the Grand Secretary.
Brother Larry A. Durr, Lodge number 551 of the 1st Masonic District. Brother James R. Shaw, Lodge number 549 of the 7th Masonic District. Brother Terrence I. Elliott, Lodge number 381 of the 19th Masonic District. Brother Jack H. Spies, Lodge number 616 of the 20th Masonic District. Brother John W. Wells II, Lodge number 342 of the 22nd Masonic District. Brother Timothy L. Schumar, Lodge number 346 of the 30th Masonic District. Brother Robert C. Snyder II, Lodge number 774 of the 34th Masonic District. Brother J. Kevin Jones, Lodge number 378 of the 35th Masonic District. Brother Arthur R. Bartholomew, Lodge number 709 of the 36th Masonic District. Brother David B. Furta, Lodge number 583 of the 49th Masonic District, and Brother John W. Postlewaite, Lodge number 276 of the 52nd Masonic District.
Would you please thank them for their service? My brothers, you may be seated, And I personally thank you for all that you've done for Freemasonry in your positions as District Deputy Grand Master. My appointments for the following positions for the year 2018 are as follows. Take your places as your name is announced by the Grand Secretary.
Right, Worshipful Grand Master. Brother David A. Aukey, Lodge number 706, Senior Grand Deacon. Brother Michael R. Rosenberry, Lodge number 629, Junior Grand Deacon. Brother David G. Engel, Lodge number 315, Grand Steward. Brother Dwayne A. Collier, Lodge number 262, Grand Steward. Brother John A. Fair, Lodge number 521, Grand Marshal. Brother Russell W. Baker, Lodge number 405, Assistant Grand Marshal. Brother Alan R. Bidle, Lodge number 315, Grand Sword Bearer. Brother Glenn S. Treese, Lodge number 666, Grand Pursuivant. Brother Edward J. Stum, Lodge number 309, Grand Tyler. And Brother Brian K. Fritz, Lodge number 284, Assistant Grand Tyler.
Kind of makes me wish I'd put my contacts in. I can see what's going on back there. And would you join me in welcoming then to the Grand Line I should say appointed Grand Line, somebody be upset with me. And also to thank those gentlemen who have served for the last 2 years in those same positions. The following are the newly appointed Grand Chaplains. Please stand to be recognized as your names are announced by the Grand Secretary.
Right, Worshipful Grand Master. Brother Nathan C. Minnick, Lodge number 570. Brother David A. Eichelberger, Lodge number 812.
And would you please help me recognize and thank them for their service. And thank you, gentlemen. Past Grand Masters, Grand Lodge Officers, District Deputies, past and present, local Blue Lodge Officers, Officers, Pendant Body Officers, Brethren, family, and guests. Thank you for being here today as we celebrate another milestone in the Pennsylvania Grand Lodge history. And as honored as I am to be the Grand Master of Masons in Pennsylvania, I am conscious that this office is not an honor, but rather is a responsibility. Honor, if it comes at all, should come to those who fulfill their responsibility to our fraternity and to our individual brothers. Some of you are aware and perhaps share my interest in the fascination with history and specifically the history of our craft. Keeping that in mind, allow me to share three names that may not be familiar to all of you. Henry M. Phillips, Matthias Henderson, and John A. Lathwood. Each of those men served as Grand Master of Masons in Pennsylvania at one time in our history. And just as many of you may not have recognized their names as important to the continuation of craft masonry, it's safe to assume that within 20 years, my name and the names of our current dignitaries from appendant bodies will be forgotten or never heard of by the men who will then be tasked and inspired to carry the lessons of our fraternity forward to future generations. And that is as it should be. For it is the values contained in our ritual and our charges that are used to reinforce those lessons of morality and decency that are the heart of what we are and what we purport to be. It is not a Grand Master or the officers of the Grand Lodge that should be the center of our attention, but rather the individual member who comes to the fraternity seeking to better himself and the society in which we live. That is not to say that this Grand Master is not both conscious of and grateful for the opportunity that has been afforded him. Over the next 2 years, this administration will do everything in its power to bring continued honor and respect to our craft. It's important that we keep in mind that the Grand Lodge, in constituting the lodges in our jurisdiction, not only holds authority over them, but also has a responsibility to them to maintain constitutional order and to provide them with direction and opportunity to better their membership and the community they serve. If we're not doing that, or they are not doing that, there's no reason for either to exist. I mention all of that as a way of emphasizing that we are not celebrating the installation of a new Grand Master today. We are celebrating the continuation of our fraternity. We are celebrating the values this craft teaches men who join it, and we are celebrating those men who choose to live those values. And while the name of this Grand Master will also be lost to history and time, you should know that it will be the effort of this Masonic caretaker to do all that can be done to not only pay homage to our past, but also pave the way for future generations of Freemasons to carry our message of decency, brotherhood, and leadership to a world that sorely needs to know that those values are cherished by mankind and that they need to be emulated if we are to advance, not just as a fraternity, but as a society. It may be harder to become a Freemason in Pennsylvania over the next 2 years, but the men who join our ranks will have a better sense that they have joined in the quest for something larger than themselves and worthwhile in their personal development as human beings. If individual lodges are not fulfilling their duty to perpetuate the craft in their communities, there's no need for them to continue. And if we are not working toward and demonstrating a commitment to our values and a positive face in the world in our local lodges, then perhaps it's time for poorly run lodges to merge with stronger lodges or close altogether until men who more fully understand the Masonic standard of excellence come forward to carry that banner in their communities. Toward that end, we will emphasize what we offer as a fraternity. We want men to be aware that Freemasonry offers them the prospect to learn, to lead, and to serve for the betterment of themselves, their families, and their fellow men. This administration will be focused on providing educational opportunity for the member. Both the new member and the tenured Mason deserve to be made aware of what we have offered the world and also what we are capable of offering with their participation. We need to emphasize the importance of the individual member in spreading the lessons of Freemasonry. Our ritual is an important part of how we teach the lessons of our craft, but we can't let our values be trapped in our ritual. We need to live the lessons that we teach, and we need to offer opportunities to every man who knocks at the portals of Freemasonry. I hadn't anticipated being asked to go through the Grand Line, so it's only been a few years that I've been thinking about what I might do or hope to accomplish as Grand Master. One of the advantages of a progressive line is the opportunity to explore some ideas, Discard the bad ones and then focus on what you hope will be a benefit to the fraternity as you become familiar with various lodges and their individual cultures throughout the jurisdiction. In some jurisdictions, the office of Grand Master is purely political, with anyone capable of running for the Grand Line in any election cycle. And while some of you may like that idea, I have seen and heard of enough turmoil in those other jurisdictions to convince me that we have a good system of elevating men to Grand Master without jeopardizing the craft if a weak Grand Master emerges for a single term. It's important to keep in mind that the Grand Lodge of Pennsylvania has been in existence longer than the United States of America. And while some jurisdictions are forced to close their Masonic homes due to poor leadership, our Masonic villages are strong and a viable option for older Masons and their families within the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. Despite what anyone may feel, we must be doing something right here in Pennsylvania. Along with its longevity, the Grand Lodge of Pennsylvania has a diversity that, unless you take advantage of visitation opportunities, may not be obvious just by reading the Pennsylvania Freemason or through the occasional conversation with a brother from another lodge. By having the luxury of interacting for a few years with men from around the state, the current system has given me the opportunity to bounce ideas off of trusted deputies and other interested brethren. Most of my initial ideas came from my own experiences within the craft. They were good for me, so why wouldn't they allow others to experience the joy that I have received from Freemasonry? But the more I discuss those things with other areas of the jurisdiction, the more I see that we can't all fit into the same Masonic mold. We live in a diverse state, diverse both in geography and economic opportunity. Those two things alone speak volumes as to what we can expect or have the right to demand from our subordinate lodges and their individual members. Let me give you an example. In my district, you don't become a worshipful master unless you have conferred or been certified in all three degrees. So requiring 2 degrees before going to the East doesn't strike me as a hardship. But when you talk to deputies that have lodges that aren't bringing in members, they have trouble convincing officers of the necessity of learning the degree work. And while I believe the lessons taught in our degrees are of value and worthy of learning for their own sake, it's difficult to argue this point with a man when we have encouraged learning the work more for the purpose of reciting it than living its lessons. Deputies will have the opportunity to argue that point with me as long as they can demonstrate that what they are doing to perpetuate the lessons of our fraternity within their district and explain why some men should be allowed to be leaders in their lodges without demonstrating the same sort of dedication required of their peers throughout the jurisdiction. A past master's jewel or apron should be a recognition of service to the fraternity and not presented to men whose only real service was to stand in the East and keep a struggling lodge alive without offering leadership to make it stronger. Mine will be a term of administrative experimentation. District deputies will be given a lot more latitude in how they run their district, with the understanding that there are difficulties in making each district flourish. That latitude will be given with the admonition to demonstrate how the fraternal lessons are being taught and how they are being maintained for future generations of Masons within their district and the lodges for whom they are responsible. If we cannot guarantee the perpetuation of our life lessons through some characterization of our ritual, then we are not a Masonic lodge, we're a Masonic club. I will expect deputies to show me how they're moving the fraternity forward in their district and be willing to work with them toward that end. This Grand Master will not be looking to build monuments to history, but rather to build Masons who understand our place in history and their individual responsibility to the future. No Grand Master can expect to have a day-to-day understanding of what is happening throughout the jurisdiction. That is both the historical and very practical reason that district deputies exist. And just as I believe the office of Grand Master is a position of responsibility more than a position of honor, we will have district deputies that share that belief about their own positions within the Grand Lodge. A local Blue Lodge can survive one or even two ineffective worshipful masters, but a district cannot thrive if it does not have a succession of capable deputies. It is the responsibility of the Grand Lodge to make certain deputies are being or doing their job for the benefit of the local lodge. That will be an expectation that you should have of your Grand Master. Where appropriate, I will still require the learning of 2 degrees, but officers will have the option of learning only the 3rd in lieu of learning the 1st and 2nd. The business of the lodge will always be a requirement for advancement. The lessons of Freemasonry are beautifully summed up in the order with which we run our meetings and the charges at the opening and closing of lodge. Those I will require from memory. They should not be just read to our lodge membership. They're too important to be treated in any way other than memorization. And if a lodge or district requires 3 degrees for advancement, the Grand Lodge requirements are not an excuse for an individual master to do less than local expectations. The Grand Lodge does not seek to weaken the example local lodges have set and do its best to reward the lodge for those efforts. Any lodge that is reading the Masonic funeral service is insulting both the deceased and his family. Every lodge should have a member who can be the worshipful master's part for memory, and they owe that to their brother. Freemasons have been leaders in their communities throughout our fraternal existence. We will still expect attendance at what will now be called officer training workshops by all going into the elected chairs, whether they have served in them before or not. And let me explain my rationale on this point. Part of strong leadership is providing for the continuation of the organization you lead. If your lodge has to keep recycling officers, then maybe that's not being accomplished and leadership development is in order. We have revised those officer training workshops to offer what we feel are more pertinent lessons, including an opportunity for lodge mentors to improve their skills. For those officers who have sat through the workshops in the past and feel put upon by being required to attend again, the Grand Lodge will offer, as an alternative, a separate leadership development seminar if the incoming officer has attended the workshops previously and wishes to attend the leadership seminar instead. As the various populations of the world develop, we have a growing need for leadership in all aspects of our lives. The Grand Lodge of Pennsylvania will be offering this course focusing on the basics of motivating and inspiring men to better themselves. This will not be a Masonic leadership course, but rather one that can be used in all aspects of a man's life. It will be our aim to see the member develop his leadership skills for use in every facet of his life, within his community, his family, and any other organization in which he finds value. You will learn more of that through your district deputy and through the Pennsylvania Freemason. There will be a nominal cost to either the member or the lodge for this particular seminar, but I promise you, you will walk away with a sense of value for the day that you spent in this environment. The world desperately needs good leadership founded on decency, compassion, and what is right as opposed to what is expedient. We are attempting to bring that point home through this leadership seminar. We will attempt to have district-wide secretary seminars run by a deputy in an attempt to have secretaries become more familiar with their counterparts and have a more local peer that they can call on for advice. Where we require regional secretary seminars, we will not burden the Grand Secretary with pushing the Grand Master's programs. Those seminars will be forums for learning and sharing experiences for the men who have given up a day for that purpose. We have an obligation to the men who will follow us into the craft to see that they experience everything they anticipated that they would gain from this association when they first petitioned the lodge. If the lodge they joined isn't providing them with that experience, we need to make them aware of the lodges that can. In this day of technology and travel advantages, we must make men aware of the opportunities available for them to fulfill their Masonic dreams. As a society, we are blessed with new ways to teach and to learn through technology. That's not to say human contact isn't a most important way to communicate, but for those Masons in Pennsylvania who want to be mentored in the mysteries and the opportunities available to our craft, we will also have online mentoring. And if the lodge they joined or their personal circumstances do not provide what they're looking for, we will use technology to get them what they are seeking from our fraternity. That opportunity becomes a reality at noon today. Additionally, we are streaming this particular gathering today to anyone who wants to watch, regardless of where they are located in Pennsylvania. We began that technology with our Academy of Masonic Knowledge in 2016. Members no longer have to travel to Elizabethtown to participate in the Academy and learn more of our fraternity than is perhaps offered in their home lodge. In regards to the Almoner's Fund, it will continue because it is a good idea and a worthy Masonic goal. As of today, it is a voluntary contribution, and I strongly urge individual Masons to give generously to that fund. Charity comes from the heart, not a mandate from Grand Lodge, and Masons don't need to be forced to fulfill their responsibility to their fellow man. Charitable needs are not restricted to Masons. There are many in your communities that need and deserve help, and if you can't find a brother who requires or wants help, find another individual within your community. Every human being has a claim upon our kind offices, but we recommend it more especially to those who are of the household of the faithful. The Almoner's Fund is to be used to help individuals and families in need of help. It is not for donating to other organizations so they can take credit for your heartfelt efforts. Don't allow that to happen in your community. As concerns the insurance solicitations members have been receiving over the last 2 years, that was a 3-year contract that was entered into without my consultation or endorsement. We were doing everything in our power to break that contract and stop those unwanted solicitations. There will be additional initiatives and changes in direction, as there always seems to be with each new Grand Master. I will share those with the district deputies and expect them to work toward accomplishing those initiatives within their district of responsibility. But as Pennsylvania Masons, you should know that I've already shared my thoughts with and asked for input from the Grand Line officers who will ultimately succeed me. We will not be initiating any expensive programs that they do not agree with. It is the hope of all of your Grand Line officers that you will begin to see a culture of continuity within the Grand Lodge, and the directions that we take going forward will be vetted as worthy by all the stakeholders, or they will not be advanced. You will see a greater sense of fiscal responsibility from your Grand Lodge. We're looking to make all Freemasons in Pennsylvania appreciate the value of the life lessons that we teach and have others see us living those values. That is accomplished from one good Mason to another, and that is, as has always been, our goal as a fraternity. It is also accomplished by having your Grand Lodge live within the same expectations that it has for our subordinate lodges. What made me come to love this fraternity and be passionate about its lessons, its values, and the relationships that it offers may not be what other men are seeking. Everyone, however, comes to the fraternity for a reason. As his brother, we owe it to him to ask, what were you looking for when you petitioned the lodge? And then steer him in that direction so he can fulfill his Masonic expectations. In doing that, we may discover something new for ourselves as well, within life and within this fraternity, thus enhancing our own Masonic journey. Let us today take the next step in Freemasonry together and continue to make our craft a force for good in the world. Thank you. Brother Grand Marshal, escort brothers Floyd Sowers, James Sieber, and Fred Doyle of Lodge Number 315 to the east for a presentation. Turn around. I want them to see you. Okay. I'm presenting today to each of these gentlemen my medallion for 2018-2019. It represents an individual member, happens to have my lodge number on it, but it is an individual member hopefully walking forward to the light of Freemasonry and to learning that can be experienced as a Freemason. It is also surrounded by several of the appendant body icons that we have, and it reads, Pennsylvania Masons, a road to leadership. Education and leadership are going to be the basic aspects of what I want to see us accomplish in Freemasonry in Pennsylvania over the next 2 years. These three gentlemen, when I entered Freemasonry in 1972, took the time over the course of my learning to teach me about Freemasonry. And I'll start with Fred Doyle over here. Fred was in the line. He was kind of keeping an eye on me. This was the 1970s, mind you. And he was invited me to come to Lodge to practice. And I showed up to Lodge to practice, and very casually. And then I showed up to work the Junior Master of Ceremonies chair. Again, the 1970s, Paisley shirts and Paisley ties were the thing. What nobody mentioned to me was that you should be dressed a little bit more formally when you're going to Lodge. And Fred was kind enough to point that out to me right after Lodge. He said, don't come here like that again. Okay? And I appreciated that. I actually dress a lot better now. But that was the beginning of that. And Fred, I do appreciate that. Okay,
you're quite welcome.
Oh, thank you. That's for you. Okay? The other aspect of Freemasonry that has always meant to me, is much to me, as I indicated earlier, was the history of Freemasonry. And Floyd Sowers over here got me involved in all sorts of historic organizations. He got me looking at things, and it's been a wonderful journey, even more so as a result of Floyd. And so I do appreciate all that you have done for me as well.
Okay? Thank you, Gene.
You're quite welcome. Now, I need to tell you that Floyd has heard just about every speech that I have given to the Masonic community. I've just valued his input, and I think I liked it best because at the end of most of them, he said, well, that's good. You don't have to touch that a bit. Whether he was kind or not, I'm not sure, but I've always enjoyed calling Floyd and indicating to him that I have something for you to hear, and he has given me good feedback, and I've appreciated that. And Jim Sieber, oh, please. Okay. And Jim Sieber was very instrumental in getting me involved with Scottish Rite and other appendant body organizations. Shortly after I got out of the East, which is when I wanted to finally get involved with it, I went through a divorce. I was a single parent, and I didn't have time to do all of the other things in Freemasonry that it would take me a long time to get involved in. But Jim was always encouraging me to go to Scottish Rite, to get involved. He was encouraging me to go to York Rite. It took me a long time to get involved in all of those things. But when I did, everything that he told me about them was absolutely correct. They are a wonderful addition to your Masonic repertoire, your Masonic education, to your Masonic journey. And Jim, I appreciate that very much as well. Okay. Please, come on in here a little bit. We're gonna take a picture. Woo! Okay. You got us? Okay. Brother Grand Marshal, please conduct these gentlemen to their seat, and thank you very much for all you've done for me. Brother Grand Marshal, escort Brother Eric M. Dye, past State Master Counselor, International Order of DeMolay, to the East for a presentation. I don't know what's doing this, but huh? I can't imagine that this is going to, all right? Good. The photographers make you look good. All right. I want to present Eric with the Master Builders Award presented to Eric M. Dye, Greenleaf Lodge number 561. We're redoing this. He had actually earned this a little earlier, but I wanted to be able to present it to him for two reasons. First of all, I watched him in Demolay. He's done an excellent job. He's helped that organization. He's learned from that organization, and he's inspired members of that organization. Secondly, he's the grandson of Ralph Slider, who went into the district deputy corps at the same time I did. And you can see the influence of Ralph, because Eric sat way in the back, and Ralph would do something like that just to get the attention as he went the whole way up. Eric, thank you for participating in the Master Builders Award. That will be continuing under my administration. It started under past Grand Master Jay Smith's administration, and it is something that I think has given an opportunity for individual members, newer members, to find out what all we have to offer in Freemasonry. It will continue, and hopefully we will continue to see stronger Masons as a result of it. Thank you.
Thank you, Grand Master.
You're quite welcome. You'll notice he gets the attention going back, too. It's another Ralph Slider thing he did there. Brethren, at this time, your Grand Lodge would be pleased to receive any contributions and or gifts from members, lodges, or Masonic districts. And if there are none, I'll understand. But if you do have something, feel free to come forward. I thought I'd see you. How are you doing? What do we have?
Right, Your Worship.
Let's step over here. You go. Am I okay now?
Right, Worshipful Grand Master.
Yes, sir.
As potentate elect of the Oasis of Zembo Shrine, it is my great honor on behalf of our 2,100 members to present you with your Grand Master's Fez for Zembo Shrine.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I look forward to wearing it.
Thank you.
Okay. Appreciate you coming up here. Get away from me. Okay. Thank you. Appreciate it. I'll let you do that. Okay. Is this a gift certificate?
Yes, it is. McDonald's.
Oh, right. Here, I'll tell you, take the microphone. Yeah.
Right, Worshipful Grand Master, from the Lodges of District A, I present to you $1,250.
Thank you very much.
For various Masonic charities.
It'll be a Masonic charity going to the library and museum, and it'll be used to start to bring record all those Masonic names that have been in the past that have not been recorded in a place where they aren't going to be destroyed. We'll be working on that. Please thank the members of District A. I appreciate it, too.
Will do.
Okay. Thank you. Right, Worshipful Grand Secretary, have you any further business?
Right, Worshipful Grand Master?
No, no.
I have no business.
Okay, I was wondering about that. Okay. At this time, I'd like to call on Brother L. Arby Humphrey, Most Worshipful Grand Master of the Grand Lodge of Wisconsin, to respond for the distinguished guests.
Right Worshipful Grandmaster.
Most
Sounds
worshipful
good. Grandmaster. Most Worshipful Brothers, Right Worshipful Sirs, distinguished guests, family, brothers all, I am truly humbled because it's a great honor and privilege for me to speak on behalf of this most distinguished group that has traveled here from out of state and around the countries for this great event. And we're all delighted to be here. Delighted because of the fellowship and the common purpose that we all share in Freemasonry. I want to say thank you to our past Grand Master Ray Dietz and his Lady Lynn for your friendship and your guidance. You have quietly led by example and provided a phenomenal example of the very highest standards of Masonic leadership. And I also want to share a story with you all. Several years ago, my wife Cindy and I attended an annual meeting of the Scottish Rite in Philadelphia to receive our 33rd degree. And not surprisingly, I found myself seated next to a Pennsylvania Mason who is now, as happens to be standing here today, as your Grand Master. And at that time, neither one of us had any clue that we'd be Grand Masters. But in the few minutes that we had before the service started, we struck up a conversation. And of course, we discovered that we have common interests. We had both been studying the different generations of men in our fraternity, and we are also interested in what each other's state were doing to promote Masonry and educate our members. Now, as I said, we only had a few minutes to talk before the service, and so we just exchanged business cards and agreed to share a couple things with each other by email. And in the next month, we did follow up and emailed each other and shared some materials. And I was thrilled to receive a tie from the Pennsylvania Grand Master. And the following year, at the Scottish Rite annual event, we ran into each other again. And we spoke for just very briefly. And we agreed that we should try to get together with our wives for dinner at the following year at the next meeting when we planned to be together again. And that was scheduled to be in Washington, D.C. Well, I kind of forgot about all that until a few months before the meeting, I received a call from Right Worshipful Brother Herod. And he reminded me of our agreement and said that really to get together, the reality of it was that we'd both be too busy that week and there was too much things going on during that time. And then he invited myself and my lady Cindy to spend the weekend at his home prior to the meeting, and offered to pick us up at the airport after the weekend and drop us off at the hotel. And we accepted that invitation and we had a great time and have become great friends since then. But now I want to stop and summarize all this for you for a minute. Now listen to this story. I ran into a stranger at a meeting in another state and we spoke for a few minutes. And after that, we shared a little information and a couple emails and seen each other briefly at another meeting the following year. We certainly did not know each other well. And then this guy invites me and my wife to spend the weekend at his home. Now, in the context of today's world, think about that. It kind of has the making of a good horror story if you think about it. But anyway, we did accept the invite. And we've become great friends. But now I want to ask you, in what world does that happen? In what world does that happen? And I see a lot of you nodding your heads, and you know the answer, because the answer is, it happens in our world. And because we're all a part of that great Masonic family, you know the answer. With everything that goes on in the world today, the scheming, the crime, the intolerance, the hate, isn't it nice to be a part of this great fraternity and trust that people surrounding us share them same kind of virtues and values that we share? People that we might not be well acquainted with, but who we can really trust. The weekend that I spent with Right Worshipful Brother Gene Herod and Sally reminded me once again of that something very special about our fraternity. I was reminded about it, what feels like to be a Mason, and it's a great feeling. And you know, As I come here and share this event today with all of you, I feel that again and reminded of a passage in our ritual that says, "Behold how good and pleasant it is to dwell together in unity." Now, Right Worshipful Grandmaster Herod is no doubt passionate about Masonry, and he is an experienced and a knowledgeable leader who demonstrates the personification of brotherly love and our Masonic virtues. Pennsylvania has had the great fortune of a proud history of outstanding great grandmasters, and many of them are sitting beside us here today. And many Masonic leaders from Pennsylvania have set a standard for this great fraternity, and I'll show you this, that you can look forward to a continuance of that great tradition. Now, today we talked about many virtues in Masonry, and you've witnessed several virtues, and you're witnessing three more, which are faith, hope, and charity. It took a lot of faith, a great leap of faith, for them to invite me here to speak on behalf of the Grand Masters to a Grand Lodge that's over 10 size, times the size of our Grand Lodge. That was a great leap of faith. And, you know, as I stand here talking, I can see a little hope on some of your faces that this will not be another one of those long-winded grandmaster speeches. And so, as I come to a conclusion, there'll probably be a little appreciation from you, from me, to stop talking, and we can only consider that as a great charity. So, with that, thank you for the warmth and hospitalities and amenities offered to all of us, and may God bless you and guide you and bless our great fraternity. Thank you.
Thank you, Arby, and as you go back to your seat, let me assure you it was not a leap of faith. I'd had too many conversations with you. I knew you would do something worthwhile, for not just for the Grand Lodge of Wisconsin, but for the Grand Lodge of Pennsylvania, and we appreciate it. Brother J.W. Smith, Right Worshipful Past Grand Master, have you anything to offer for the good of Freemason in general, or this Grand Lodge in particular, on behalf of the Grand Master, past Grand Masters present?
Grandmaster, it is a honor and a privilege to represent these past grandmasters sitting on your left-hand side here. And we want to congratulate and our past grandmaster, Ray Dietz, and Lady Lynn for the service they have provided the last 2 years for this great fraternity of ours. And Brother Dietz, we welcome you into the past grandmasters, I think, right? But it's just a great opportunity. And Grandmaster, I want to go back 6 years ago in this very room.
Yes, sir.
You started your journey through the Grand Line and Freemasonry. And through those 6 years, you have provided all kind of leadership through the Lodge of Research, the Academy of Knowledge, and everything that you have provided in those 6 years, you provided it to the lodges and the membership. Everywhere we went, you were one of the first ones to mingle with the members and also with the officers of the lodge to make them feel easy and appreciate everything that they were doing in the lodge. So it was great. 6 years of training, 6 years of leadership, and 6 years of wisdom that was provided to all of us. Every one of these past grandmasters sitting behind me, when they come into office, they always want to do something that will have a lasting impression upon the fraternity. And each one does their best. And each one of us try to reach that goal. And Grandmaster, I look at you and I see no difference, because with the program that you have outlined today, you're also going to let an impression on this fraternity of ours in the future. Brother Thurston, in their sermon at the Vesper service, mentioned leadership and wisdom. And with your inaugural speech today, you exemplified both of those. You're giving authority back to the lodges. You're making them feel more comfortable. You're making them be leaders within their communities and within their lodges. And also the brethren. What an opportunity to learn through these programs for the future. You know, the Grand Master, I look at and say, you know, you had education in your mind all through your Masonic journey. And I'm glad to see that you're going to carry it through your next 2 years. We never stop learning. And I think you have proven that over these past years. Just remember one thing. You cannot do everything yourself. It's impossible. That's why you have the district deputies. That's why you have the Grand Lodge line to help you to achieve your goals. And I'd just like to say one more thing before closing. Sally, congratulations. I can remember when we sat down and talked about this 6 years ago, and she has some questionable things about what was going to happen. But so did the Grand Master. But I want to congratulate both of you on a very successful 6 years, and I know it'll be successful 2 years ahead. To all the Grand Lodge ladies, to all the ladies of the deputies and so forth that are here today, none of us could have done it without your support and your dedication to our fraternity, believe me. So Grandmaster, I congratulate you on achieving this position. I congratulate you on the programs that you are going to provide over the next 2 years for our lodges and our members. And I look forward to working with you at any time that you need your help. Every one of the past Grand Masters are here to assist you. All we can do is give you our comments. You still have the final decision. So, Grand Master, thank you very much, and have a great 2 years, and especially a happy new year. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Brother Jay. Right, Worshipful Grand Secretary. Have you anything to offer for the good of Freemasonry in general?
Right, Worshipful Grandmaster.
In particular.
Right, Worshipful Grandmaster. First, I'd like to congratulate Right, Worshipful Past Grandmaster, Brother Raymond T. Dietz, on a very successful 2 years. It was my pleasure to be able to work with you. And Lady Karen and I thank you and Lady Lynn for everything you've done for us and our travels together. And we know you're not going to totally go away. You'll come back a little bit, but now it's time, I guess, to do some fishing. Right, Worshipful Grandmaster, I'd like to congratulate you on a very successful annual communication. I know you have a very aggressive agenda ahead of you. I look forward to being part of that. And I'd like to congratulate the other Grand Lodge officers and a very fine installation service today. And I'd just like to wish everybody a very prosperous new year, and hope it's a good one for all. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Right, Worshipful Junior Grand Warden, have you anything to offer?
Right Worshipful Grand Master, I'd like to congratulate you on being installed as the new Right Worshipful Grand Master. I'd like to thank the Right Worshipful Past Grand Master Raymond Dietz and Lynn for their 2 years of leadership. I'd also like to thank the other Grand Lodge officers have been installed today, and thank the brethren, ladies, and distinguished guests for taking time out to come to our meeting. It was a great annual. Thank you, Right Worshipful Grand Master. One other thank you goes out to my wife, Shelley, and my son, Dustin, and the friends on the sideline. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Larry. Good move throwing your family in there. Right Worshipful Senior Grand Warden, have you anything to offer?
Right Worshipful Grand Master, I want to thank past Grand Master Dietz and Lynn and Jessica for welcoming Sharon and I and all the opportunities that we've had and the way we were treated the last couple of years. I am truly in your debt. And I'd also like to take an opportunity to report to Brother Sturgeon that while I don't play gin rummy incessantly with the Grand Master as you do, after a 2-year period, I am only down $10. The reason for that is I don't know how to play and he doesn't know what to expect. So maybe you might take a lesson. Anyway, and I would also like to congratulate you. I'm looking for, Grandmaster, I'm looking forward to a productive 2 years. I'm excited with all the communications we've had and the things we plan to do together. And I congratulate you and Sally as you begin your term. I'd also like to congratulate all the appointed officers today who are going to come on this journey with us. And I'd especially like to thank my wife for all her support. And my our kids are here today and everybody that attended. And we also have relatives here from Texas. So thanks for coming up. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Right Worshipful Deputy Grand Master, have you anything to offer?
Right Worshipful Grand Master, thank you. I first like to start to say thank you, Brother Ray, past Grand Master, and Lady Lynn. It's truly been a hoot traveling with you two the past 2 years. Thank you. Right Worshipful Grand Master, yes. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Traveling with you over the last 4 years, we traveled extensively together with you and Lady Sally, and we've always had a great time. We look forward to it the next 2 years. And Cheryl, thank you. Cheryl and children, thanks so much. Cheryl and I would like to say thank you to everyone and have a safe and prosperous Happy New Year. Thank you.
You're welcome. You cut that short, didn't you?
I did.
I don't blame you. All right. As if you hadn't heard enough from me, I have some closing remarks. First of all, I have a tradition that I started 6 years ago when my then 8-year-old grandson sat throughout this whole thing and saw me installed as junior grand warden. 2 years later as senior grand warden, 2 years later as deputy grand master, and today sat here and watched me installed as grand master and was kind enough to stick his hand out and congratulate me as I came back down there. I've often talked about him, but I don't know that I've actually shown him. Lyric, you're tall enough now. They'll see you. This is my grandson, Lyric. I am so grateful for him being here. He and his mother had their lives kind of turned upside down. They live on St. John, and St. John was hit within 2 weeks by 2 Category 5 hurricanes. Lyric is now living in Philadelphia, going to Abington Friends School, doing well. He is back and forth to St. John and rebuilding their lives. That will happen. There's persistence and determination in both of those individuals. I'm very proud of both of them, and they will get themselves back to where they wish to be and where they deserve to be. I do want to thank all of my family who was able to be here today for all of this. I can't tell you how much I've appreciated it, and in particular, Sally. And it was almost worth not kissing you for 4 days so we didn't come here sick. But now we'll go back to doing that the way we should.
I do want to congratulate all of the elected Grand Line officers. I look forward to working with all of you. I think we're going to have a good 2 years. I think we're going to have a good 8 years, because we're going to communicate with one another. We're going to see what needs to be done, and we're going to sit down and look at it and do it together. The appointed officers, you'll have a good ride. Thank you for coming along with us. And for everybody else who was here today, I can't tell you how much I've appreciated your attendance. I know those, if you weren't here for me and you were here for somebody else, they were appreciative as well. Grandmaster Ray, thank you so much for being a part of the Grand Lodge, for putting all of this together for us so that we could follow your lead going forward. Lady Lynn, most of the toasts that I gave were to your hospitality, but I appreciated what both of you did for us. And we did appreciate it. That being said, I have a couple of announcements. The combined luncheon will be immediately following the close of the Grand Lodge in the red and blue rooms of the Great American Hall, which is where we had breakfast for those of us who were here for breakfast. Special Masons Only meeting of Cumberland Valley Lodge number 315 will be held after lunch at 1:30 p.m. of the Chocolate Ballroom, which is right here. That will be for Master Masons only. And okay, I should explain to you, perhaps if you do not know, traditionally the first meeting that a Grand Master goes to after the Grand Lodge installation is to his home lodge. It's a lot easier on the home lodge if we bring all those people back in here rather than going to our home lodge. So that will be my first meeting with my home lodge, assuming that the people who were supposed to bring everything brought everything. The June quarterly communication of Grand Lodge will be held on Saturday, June the 9th, 2018, at 10 o'clock a.m. at the Penn Stater in State College, Pennsylvania. And I want to extend thanks to Brother Bob Trimble, past master, New London Lodge number 545, Brother Jeff Leese, member Thompson Lodge number 340, Grand Lodge organist, and Brother Raymond E. Foose, member of Newton Lodge number 427, Solus Extraordinaire, for your presentations today. Very much appreciated. Brother Nathan C. Minnett, Grand Chaplain, give the closing prayer and invocation for lunch.
May the blessings of heaven rest on us and on all regular Freemasons. May we practice out of the Grand Lodge those principles of religion and morality we are taught within it. May every moral and social virtue cement us in the bonds of peace and fraternal love, and procure thy gracious favor, O blessed Lord God, who livest and reignest in indescribable glory and happiness, and has, throughout the generations that rise and fall before you, opened your hand and supplied the needs of every living thing. Bless now the abundance of the fruits of the earth, of which we will partake for the strengthening of our bodies. But most importantly, this day, we ask that you would impart upon our new Right Worshipful Grand Master the same spirit that was imparted upon Holy Saint John, that he might forever proclaim the good news that you have for all mankind in charity and in peace. We ask this in your most blessed name. Amen. So mote it be.
Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me. Let there be peace on earth, a peace that was meant to be with God as a father. With my brother in perfect harmony. Let peace begin with me. Let this be the moment now. With every step
Correction, I indicated that the Cumberland Valley 315 Lodge was at 1:30. I misread that. It is at 2:30. And again, all Master Masons are welcome. I now declare this grand communication closed. Brethren and guests, please stand fast until the Grand Lodge has recessed. Brother Grand Marshal, form the recessional.
Grand Tyler, Grand Persephants, Grand Stewards, Grand Deacons, Grand Chaplains, aides to the Grand Master, District Deputy Grandmasters, District Deputy Grandmasters, distinguished guests of the Right Worshipful Grandmaster, Right Worshipful Past Grand Secretary, Right Worshipful Past Grand Treasurer. Right Worshipful Past Grand Masters. Right Worshipful Grand Secretary, Right Worshipful Grand Treasurer. Right Worshipful Junior Grand Warden, Right Worshipful Senior Grand Warden. Right Worshipful Deputy Grandmaster. Grand Lodge Party, open order, inward face. The Right Worshipful Grandmaster.